Here's the descending limb. So let's kind of get your bearings. This is the lumen of the ascending loop. So this would be the apical membrane. And then the basolateral membrane would be here. And you have your interstitial fluid and your blood off to the side of that. So once again, you've got your sodium potassium pump. So that's the first one that we've always been talking about. So we know we have a low concentration of sodium inside the cell, and we have a high concentration of potassium inside the cell as well. So knowing that then, that tells us that sodium must be at a high concentration in the lumen. What this diagram is showing is the fact that you can transport potassium using this little transporter here, and potassium would go from a low concentration in the lumen to a high concentration in the cytoplasm of the cell. So this is going to be sodium potassium co-transport. So it's a type of secondary active transport. Now, sodium can also be transported via chloride ions. So chloride ions would be going from a low concentration toward a high concentration. So that means that you can have sodium chloride co-transport as well. So sodium can be co-transported with chloride, or sodium can be co-transported with potassium. And now let's focus on the basolateral membrane and how potassium and chloride ions get across the basolateral membrane. So the reality is that you have a carrier protein here for potassium. So potassium is going from a high concentration toward a low concentration of potassium. So this is facilitated diffusion across the basolateral membrane. Then we also have chloride ions, okay, that are using facilitated diffusion. So we are here, we have chloride ions going from a high concentration to a low concentration of chloride. So this is also a type of facilitated diffusion across the basolateral membrane. So over here, we're on this ascending limb, and we've reabsorbed sodium, potassium, and chloride ions. So by reabsorbing them, we take them out of the lumen, and so that is going to alter the interstitial fluid for a period of time until it gets into the plasma. So that's caused this interstitial fluid to become hypertonic. So what we've just done then, by having the interstitial fluid hypertonic, that forces the water to be reabsorbed. So we've created an osmotic gradient for water. In the descending limb, that again is only permeable to water. Water is moving out of the lumen into a more hypertonic interstitial fluid. Remember once again that the ascending limb is only permeable to solutes. It's not permeable to water. Okay, then we have the countercurrent multiplier system. And like I mentioned in lecture, this is a really good animation of the countercurrent multiplier system. It's such a dynamic process that I think it's easier to watch how the filtrate moves through and how it affects the osmolarity of the lumen, because you're looking at how it affects the descending and ascending limbs at the same time. So it's much easier to watch an animation and see those changes than it is for me to sit here and step you through it. With all that being said, I would still be really happy to help you with the countercurrent multiplier system if you don't understand it.